Hi, I'm Bill Barry, NASA Chief Historian. We're here in the NASA Headquarters Historical Reference Collection, a place where we maintain an archive of documents, records, and reference books that researchers can use and that we use to answer all sorts of questions. In addition to NASA records, we have records from the National Advisory Committee for Aeronautics, the NACA. We've been pretty busy here for the last year, getting ready to mark the centennial of the creation of the NACA. But the importance of the NACA is not just a matter of old books and dusty records. The story of the NACA is one of incredibly dedicated people pushing the cutting edge of new technologies and doing that in new and creative ways. It had such a revolutionary impact on our world that we hardly notice it these days, but you might not have guessed this from its modest beginnings. With the passage of the Naval Appropriations Act on March 3, 1915, the NACA came into existence. Its mission, to supervise and direct the scientific studies of the problems of flight with a view to their practical solution, and to determine the problems which should be experimentally attacked, and to discuss their solution and their application to practical questions. Originally, the committee was just that. It was a 12-member group appointed from the military and other parts of the government, and also from academia and industry experts. Although it would be 2 years before the United States joined the conflict, in 1915, war was already raging across Europe and on the oceans, and also it had moved into the air. It was just about a dozen years since the Wright brothers' first successful flights at Kitty Hawk, but much to our surprise, the United States found itself to be far behind Europe in aeronautics. How did that happen? Well, after the Wrights demonstrated their flyer in France in 1908, European governments and individuals began to invest millions in aeronautics research. By 1912, the French government was spending $6.4 million annually on aircraft research and construction. The Russian Empire wasn't far behind that year with $5 million. In the United States government, spending on aviation in 1912 was only $140,000. By 1911, every major country in Europe had a government-funded aeronautics laboratory. As a result, by the start of World War I, Europe was far ahead in aircraft technology, and even in the sheer numbers of military airplanes. When the war started, the French fielded 1,400 military airplanes, Germany 1,000, Imperial Russia had 800, and Great Britain 400. The United States at the start of the war, we had just 23 military aircraft. The United States was certainly not against technology at the time. After all, by December of 1915, Henry Ford had rolled his 1 millionth car off the assembly line. Silent films were all the rage. But between the Wright brothers' patents and a lack of government interest, we lagged far behind Europe in aeronautics and wound up having to use European aircraft when we entered the war. At the first meeting of the committee on April 23, 1915, they selected an executive committee to manage the day-to-day issues. Charles Walcott, secretary of the Smithsonian Institution, was chosen as chairman of the executive committee. And even though the committee members were not paid, their meager $5,000 budget did not go very far. For the most part, it went to pay researchers in academia and other government agencies. The committee would issue a research authorization on a topic that it thought was of interest, and others would do the work. Executive Committee Chairman Walcott and a group of others had much greater hopes. Walcott made it his business to push for the construction of NACA research facilities. It was an uphill struggle. President Wilson himself opposed, but Congress voted in favor of adding $85,000 to the NACA budget for a laboratory in 1916. And work on it finally began in 1917. It was named in honor of Walcott's predecessor as secretary of the Smithsonian, the Langley Memorial Aeronautical Laboratory, and it rose slowly near Hampton, Virginia, until it was completed in 1920. Eventually, the NACA would grow to a total of 3 major laboratories and 2 major test facilities. Just before World War II, Ames Research Center was built in California's Bay Area. This was quickly followed by the Aircraft Engine Research Laboratory in Cleveland, Ohio. After the war, this was renamed in honor of the late NACA Director of Research, George Lewis, the Lewis Laboratory. It's since been renamed in honor of Ohio native John Glenn. After the war, the NACA also established a test facility at Wallops Island, Virginia, and a high-speed flight test research facility in the high desert of California. It's now known as the Armstrong Flight Research Center. These facilities, and the amazing people who worked at them, were responsible for many breakthroughs in aeronautics and space. But for the 200 or so people that worked at Langley, the first big breakthrough came in the late 1920s. Using what was then the world's largest wind tunnel, and one designed originally to study propellers, NACA researchers, led by Fred Weick, discovered that wrapping airplane engines in a properly shaped metal cowling not only reduced the drag on the airplane, but it actually improved engine cooling. Now, up to that point, airplane engines had usually been fully exposed, in the belief that this was the only way to keep them from overheating. But this finding had huge effects, increasing the speed and range of aircraft at an extremely small cost to manufacturers. In 1929, the NACA was awarded the first of five Collier trophies. Collier is an award given every year for the greatest achievement in aeronautics research. But it also led to a significant budget increase for the NACA, which allowed it to build many, many more facilities at Langley. The NACA is probably best known for its many wind tunnels, ones that could simulate various speeds and altitudes, and it ranged in size from able to accommodate small models to full-size airplanes. But the NACA used a variety of other facilities, for example, tow tanks to study amphibious and float planes. The NACA also pioneered the field of systematic flight research. Starting with a couple of borrowed Army JN-4 Jennies, NACA technicians developed the tools and equipment needed to take precise measurements in the air, freeing the research pilots from having to take handwritten notes. They used this equipment to study the performance of airfoils and also the structure of airplanes to make sure that they didn't break up under the stresses of flight, which was a common problem in the 1920s. In essence, the very shape of modern aircraft is a result of research done by the committee. The French Caudron G4 represented the peak of aircraft design in 1915, and it was a plane that was used by all the Allies during World War I, including the United States. But in about two dozen years, airplane design changed dramatically, and to the shape that we all recognize now. A metal tubular body, engines mounted on the front of the wings, a single wing, and one that's placed low down on the body. All of these elements were tested and proven by NACA research in the 1920s and 30s. NACA shared this research with the world and did its work in partnership with industry. As a result, NACA research was embedded into the airplane as we know it. It's part of the DNA of airplanes. In fact, NACA designed wings were not only on U.S. aircraft during World War II, but on Allied aircraft like the British Spitfire, and even enemy aircraft like the German Focke-Wulf 190. In addition to innovations in aircraft and research, the NACA also began to try new things with its staff prior to World War II. In the mid-1930s, the NACA hired computers to deal with the huge flow of data coming from all those wind tunnels and flight research tests. Now, these weren't computers like we think of them now. They were women. Interestingly enough, as labor shortages grew during World War II, the NACA reached across the racial barrier and hired African-American women to serve as computers as well. While this was a small step, it represented a major shift with repercussions that would echo long after. World War II changed a lot of things, including the pace of work done at the NACA, and the kind of work being done as well. Virtually every aircraft flown by the United States in the war was tested and improved in the wind tunnels at Langley and Ames. Engine performance and reliability was also raised to new levels by work at Cleveland at what's now the Glenn Research Center. The cumulative effect of all this work had a huge impact on the course of World War II, and it gave the Allies an important margin in ensuring victory in the air. After the conclusion of two world wars, the jet age had arrived. And NACA was at the cutting edge of this technology as well, with flight test improvements and various developments. The NACA established a new type of partnership with the Air Force and Bell Aircraft to build a research craft aimed at achieving supersonic flight. In 1947, Air Force pilot Chuck Yeager would be the first person to fly supersonic in the Bell X-1. This work won the NACA, along with partners the Air Force and Bell, their third Collier Trophy in 1947. The best and the brightest were tackling these problems and moving forwards towards conquering the hurdles of high-speed flight. But other NACA researchers were turning their minds to the edge of space and beyond. Even in the late 1940s, the NACA was becoming a space agency. One of the most critical breakthroughs in that space research was made by Harvey Allen. One of the Langley cadre that had helped set up Ames Research Center in 1940, Allen was the chief of the high-speed research division at Ames by 1945. And in the summer of 1952, he developed the blunt body concept. Now, it had long been assumed that re-entering spacecraft would be pointed like artillery shells, or like Buck Rogers' spacecraft from the 1930s. But early experiments with designs of this sort proved disastrous, as re-entry vehicles were unable to survive the intense heat of re-entry. In another one of those counterintuitive NACA insights, Allen proposed that a blunt body shape would set up a shock wave ahead of itself and therefore keep the heat from reaching the vehicle. Instead, it would be dissipated on the shock wave. His 1952 paper on this proved quite controversial. But since the military was also interested in this question for building nuclear missile warheads, the work was classified and not well known until the late 1950s. Nonetheless, Allen and his team proved his theories in the wind tunnels at Ames, and in the process, defined the shape of all spacecraft that followed. Allen's blunt body work was not only obvious in the space capsules of the 1960s, but was also incorporated into the X-15 in various lifting bodies and the space shuttle. And today we can see it in commercial crew vehicle designs like the CST-100 and the Dragon space capsule, and also in our future capsule for deep space exploration, NASA's Orion spacecraft. Between its creation in 1915 and its recreation as NASA in 1958, the NACA's systematic approach to the problems of flight made fundamental contributions to the worldwide development of aeronautics and beyond.
The NACA is in process of great change. As you know, the final decisions are being made by the democratic processes of our chosen form of government that will result in the establishment of a new agency, the National Aeronautics and Space Agency, built around the present NACA, with responsibilities for the non-military aspects of space activities.
The culture that's the National Aeronautics and Space Administration is built on the tenacity and expertise of NACA researchers that transitioned from that NACA to NASA in 1958. It's part of the drive behind everyone with a passion for space travel and modern flight. During the 50s and 60s, aeronautics engineers transitioned into space flight directors. Leaders of the NACA brought us to the moon. Wind tunnels once used for aircraft tests are now being used to test both rockets and aircraft. Centers of aviation now built and designed and tested spacecraft. In less than 70 years, we as a nation and a world had gone from a fledgling motorized flight on a sand dune in North Carolina, to supersonic flight above California's Mojave Desert, to walking out of a spacecraft onto the lunar surface. These accomplishments, and many more, rest squarely on the shoulders of the men and women of the National Advisory Committee for Aeronautics. NASA was founded in October 1958, but it was born on the 3rd of March 1915. This legacy of excellence continues in NASA, where not only are we on a journey to Mars, building on the legacy of NACA engineers, but we continue to push the boundaries of performance and efficiency in the air. NASA's with you when you fly.
But now we have come to a new day. NACA is to become part of a new agency, the National Aeronautics and Space Administration. And this is extremely important both to you and to me as individuals and to the success of our mission. NASA must be like NACA in the qualities of strength and character that make an organization great.
We choose to go to the moon in this decade and do the other things, not because they are easy, but because they are hard.
Tranquility Base here. The Eagle has landed.
This is a legacy. This is a history well worth celebrating.